Okay, in this video, we're going to cover 1.5, which is the introductions. It's really 1.5A, which is the introduction of complex numbers. Okay, we'll use this information eventually to solve more quadratic equations, but that will be another homework assignment and another lecture in the second unit. Okay, but this will be the last section in this first unit to talk about. So we definitely have to go over a lot of definitions, and then we have to learn how to do all of our basic computations like add, subtract, multiply, and divide. The one thing that we won't do is this at the end, not yet. That is reserved for the second unit. Okay, so we won't talk about the complex solutions of quadratic equations, not yet, okay? Once we learn the quadratic formula, then we can put the two things together, okay? But right now, the only way that y'all can solve quadratic equations is by factoring or by completing the square and then extracting the roots, okay? So we don't have any other methods like the quadratic method that have been taught yet in this semester. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and move through this. Compared to P.2, this might seem a little bit simpler than P.2, although some of those skills for rational or for simplifying radicals will come in handy in this section as well. Okay, so we learned that some quadratic equations do not have real solutions, right? And the main example that they're giving us is if we have an equation x² + 1 = 0, we can't factor that because it's the sum of two squares. So we would try to extract roots by minusing the 1 over. But when I take the square root on both sides, I get plus or minus the square root of -1. And the square root of -1 is not a real number. Just like the square root of -4 or anything like that, any negative number, negative radicand, cannot be simplified. If you type it in the calculator, it literally says error, okay? Even if I change that to the square root of 1, it still says error, okay? So we can't compute the square root of negative numbers in our calculator. So what the mathematicians have done is they've expanded the number system to include things that are defined as imaginaries, okay? So instead of just saying, oh, well, I can't take the square root of -1, then out goes all square root of negative numbers that exist, right? And so then what they did was to continue having the algebra conversations. They just defined the square root of -1. They gave it a name and they called it I, okay? And then calling it I actually allows us to keep working with the algebra and manipulating these things to create whole other systems, okay? And so imaginary numbers are really super important, okay? We would not have computers without imaginary numbers. We would not have electricity without imaginary numbers. Imaginary numbers are really important for technology and electrical engineering, and even in graphics, three-dimensional figures. In order for you to put them on the computer, you'd have to use imaginary numbers. Once you get to calculus, you start learning that there's a broader realm of things that you can do with imaginaries, and sometimes you're forced to use those imaginaries, but that's not until like pre-cal, the end of pre-cal, and then cal 2 and cal 3 is when you'll start getting in there, okay? But for now, we're just starting with the very basic, which is just defining what I is, and I is the square root of -1, okay? Now, if you've established this, if I go ahead and square both sides of this statement, I get that I squared equals the square root of -1². And we know that the radical and the exponent, if they're the same, index and exponent, they will cancel each other. So essentially what you get is a new statement that says I squared is equal to -1, okay? And so now you have two definitions. You have a definition for I squared and you have a definition for I. So, excuse me. So with that said, let's start talking about this. if you add your real numbers to your imaginary numbers, okay, what you create, so here are your real numbers, right? And then here are what your imaginary numbers will look like. They'll have a coefficient and then an I next to it, okay? Really, we know that that's B times the square root of negative one, but it will always be written like this, okay? But if you were to take your reals and take your imaginary pieces and put them together, add them together, you end up with what's called a complex number, okay? And complex numbers do have a standard way that they want you to write those numbers. And it's always A plus BI, meaning the real part first, and then plus or minus, depending on the signs of your imaginary parts, okay? And they give you an example and they say, for instance, this problem here can be rewritten as negative 5, the real part still the same, but this square root part is actually equal to 3i. Why is it equal to 3i? Because negative 9 can be written, first of all, as 9 times a negative 1, right? And then instead of writing 9, you can write 3 squared times negative 1. And then we know that the square root of 3 squared will make the 3 come out, but you still have the negative 1 stuck on the inside. And then finally, when you take the square root of negative 1, that is defined as just I. And so this statement is the same as this statement, okay? Now there's a shortcut to get from here to here. And they think they talk about it. They don't talk about it for some time. So let me see if I can find that page. And then I'm gonna throw it in here. This section does seem kind of long, but it goes by so quick. So there it is. There it is. So this rule is what they're talking about. Okay. It says we already know that if you have the square root of 9, it could be written as if you have the square root of negative 9, essentially it can be written as the square root of 9 times I. What happens is that negative will come out, okay? And similarly, if you had the square root of negative 3, this negative will come out as an I. So notice that the bar does not go over the I because the I is not inside the radical anymore. But according to the standard form, they like the I all the way to the right, okay? So normally I would write it like I square root of negative 3, but that's not the standard form, okay? It does have to have the I in the back, okay? And similarly for this one, when we did that, when the square root of 9 was 3, and so we got 3i, okay? So the general rule is that if you are taking the square root of a negative number, you're just gonna take the square root of the positive of that number, and the negative comes out as the I, okay? And again, essentially what you're doing is you're saying a times a negative 1, and then doing the square root of a times the square root of negative 1, which is the square root of a times an I, okay? And so that's, it really is just trying to explain what we're doing mentally. So when you do see the square root of negative 9, your brain should be doing the square root of positive 9, which is 3, and then because of the square root of the negative, it'll have an I, okay? And so you can get straight to that result. You just have to know this property, okay? So, some more definitions, okay, before we start computing. So it says, if A and B are real numbers and the number A plus BI, that I being attached makes it an imaginary number, together it's called the complex number. And it has to be, or is said to be written in standard form when it is just like this, okay? The real number A is called the real part, and the real number B is called the imaginary part of the complex number, okay? So I'm gonna erase this, and I'm gonna say, Sorry, I'm trying to explain this a little bit better. There we go. So it says when B, I'm not even going to read all this stuff. Okay. If you have just a real number all by itself, A, when you look at the standard form, that A, it does represent the real part, and it also represents a real number, okay? The A plus BI together represents a complex number which has imaginaries in it, okay? And then B by itself in the standard form, B by itself is the imaginary part. It's just the coefficient of the I. But BI together with the I and all is called a pure imaginary number, okay? So this is called a pure real number, a pure imaginary number. Together, it's a complex number. The number itself is the real part of the standard form, and this number itself is the imaginary part of the standard form, okay? So for example, if you have 2 plus or 2 minus 5i, you're gonna say that the real part is the 2 and the imaginary part is that -5 coefficient, okay? Now we do need to recognize now that real numbers, which used to be our giant group of numbers, right? Real numbers included whole numbers, integers, radicals, positive radicals, right? Square root of positive numbers, cube roots, any odd root, only the positive of the even roots, and no, yeah, it had everything in there, okay? But now that group is only one part of a bigger group called the complex numbers. So you've got the real numbers, which have no imaginary parts. Then you have the pure imaginary numbers, which have no real parts. And together, they create what are called the complex numbers. So all of the real numbers are complex numbers, and all of the imaginary numbers are complex numbers. And even the combination of the two are complex numbers, okay? Now understand that if you have B equal to 0, it's just a real number. And if you have, and also you wanna keep in mind that if you do have a real number, it can be written like this, okay? Same thing for a pure imaginary. So if you have a pure real number, it just means that there's no imaginary component. And if you have a pure imaginary number, it just means that there's no real component. This will come in handy, probably not until you get to pre-cal, but it will come in handy knowing that information, okay? I think when you talk about conjugates, it will come in handy too. So here's equality of complex numbers. In order for two complex numbers to be equal, the real parts have to be the same and the imaginary part has to be the same. So notice that I have 2 plus 4i and 2 plus 4i. Those are in fact equal because the real part is a positive 2 and the imaginary part is a positive 4. Both pieces match. These are not equivalent. Although the real part is the same, the imaginary parts are opposite. One imaginary part is -4, the other imaginary part is +4. And so then those two are not equivalent. Similarly here, the imaginary parts are the same, +4, +4, but the real parts are not the same. And so those are not equivalent either. Excuse me, sorry. Okay, so now to work on operations of complex numbers, essentially we want to be able to add, subtract, multiply, and divide, okay? And so in order for you to add or subtract, essentially what you're doing is just combining like terms, okay? You will distribute anything in the front that needs to be distributed, distribute anything in the front that needs to be distributed, and then combine like terms. Whether it's a plus or a minus, it will work the exact same way, okay? This is just letting you know that you can distribute, okay? Even if it's just a negative, you can distribute. And if you do have a real number and then the opposite real number, they do cancel. And if you have a imaginary number and an opposite imaginary number, those will cancel as well. And you just get zero. You can write it in its formal answer, which is zero plus zero I, but the computer will just accept zero. Okay. It doesn't need to have zero I. So any complex number plus its opposite will equal zero. So if I have 3 plus 4i, and then I have -3 minus 4i. If I were to add those two together, I would get zero, okay? Which makes sense. 3 minus 3 is 0, 4i minus 4i is 0. So here's the example of them adding and subtracting. So notice if you distribute this imaginary one, this is gonna stay +4 and +7i. If you distribute this imaginary positive one, this is going to stay +1 and stay -6i. And then from here, we're just gonna combine our like terms. So we have the real numbers 4 plus 1, which is where the 5 came from. And then we have +7i minus 6i, which is a +1i. But we don't ever write that imaginary one, okay? Then the similarly here, I would take this one's imaginary and distribute it. And so I'd get 1 plus 2i, then this +1 and distribute that, I'd get +3 and -2i. The +2i and the -2i do cancel, but 1 plus 3 is where they get 4. I don't like all those steps that they try to explain. It just makes things more confusing, in my opinion. So I keep crossing them out, okay? So here I have the 3i, there's nothing going on in the front, so I just rewrote it. Then the negative times a negative is +2. Negative times a positive is a -3i. Negative times a positive is a negative. Negative times a positive is a negative. So I've distributed all of those negatives. Now I'm going to combine my like terms. So 3i and -3i do cancel. 2 and -2 do cancel. And I'm still left with this -5i, okay? Here I have a 1 to distribute. So this stays +3 and +2i. Here I have a positive to distribute. So this stays +4 and -i. Here I have a negative to distribute. So this 7 becomes -7. And this positive I becomes -i. Once we have that, we're going to compute all of our real numbers. So 3 plus 4 is 7. -7 means that they all wipe each other out and I get 0. But then I have 2i minus an i, which gives me 1i. And if I minus another i, that means I have 0 i's. So I have no reals and no imaginaries left over. Everything canceled out, everything. And so then our final answer is just gonna be 0. Okay. So we just wanna make sure you're aware that associative properties, commutative properties, and even distribution is still applicable to these complex numbers, okay? It's okay that we threw in an I, the rules still apply. And it's okay that it's an imaginary number, all the rules still apply. So for instance, here, I would distribute the A, so I don't really write this step, I just do it. A times C is AC, A times DI, I would just write as ADI, I wouldn't even put all of that. Then BI times C is C times BI, which is the same thing. BI times DI would be BD, but an I squared, okay? Then you have to remember that I squared equals -1. So this I squared becomes -1, but you still have whatever you got when you multiplied those numbers together, okay? And then once you compute that, you'll realize that this is just going to change this sign. And so that's where this minus BD comes from. So you've got two real numbers that are going to need to be added or subtracted together. And then you've got these two imaginary numbers that are also going to have to be added or subtracted. Okay. So let's look at some multiplication problems. Here it's just one number times a complex number. So you do four times negative 2 is negative 8, and 4 times 3i is positive 12i. Same thing here, 2 times 4 is 8, 2 times 3i is 6i, negative I times 4 is negative 4i, and negative I times positive 3i is negative 3i squared. Then this 3i squared is going to, or the I squared is going to turn into a negative 1. Okay. And then once that turns into a negative 1, essentially what you have here is this is 8 plus 6i minus 4i, and negative times a negative will turn into a positive 3. Then 8 plus 3 is the 11. And 6i minus 4i is where you get positive 2i, okay? So again, I don't write the steps all the way they do. They kind of like try to group stuff together. You don't need to, just combine like terms, okay? So 3 times 3 is 9. 3 times negative 2i is negative 6i. 2i times 3 is positive 6i. And then positive 2i times negative 2i is a negative 4i squared. This I squared will turn into a negative 1. Notice that these two will cancel, but this negative times a negative changes it to plus 4. So then 9 plus 4 is 13. Now, if you notice, these are special, okay? These are what are called conjugates, right? You have the same number 3 in the front, the same number 2i in the back, and one has a plus and one has a minus. Those are called conjugates, okay? You'll notice that when you have imaginary numbers and you multiply their conjugates together, you end up with a real number, okay? That is going to be the goal when you divide, because remember, i's are square roots. So if you have i's downstairs in your fractions, you have to get rid of those square roots because i's are square roots. They're square root of negative 1. So you have to get rid of those square roots. And what you'll do is you'll use conjugates to do that, okay? We'll always use conjugates to do it. Excuse me. So even if I wanted a square number, you have to remember you cannot square terms individually. You could square factors individually, so 2 squared and then I squared, which is 4i squared, or 4 times negative 1, which is negative 4. You can do this, but once there's a plus or a minus in between, you cannot square the things individually, okay? So I do have to go by the definition of a square, which means this base multiplied by itself. Okay, and then I'm going to FOIL. So 3 times 3 is 9, 3 times 2i, 6i, 2i times 3, 6i, and then 2i times 2i is 4i squared. The 4i squared will turn into a negative 1. These two guys will combine to give me a 12i, and a positive times a negative is actually a negative. So 9 minus 4 is 5, and then the 12i comes down. So because of the fact that conjugates multiply to give you a real number, we're always going to be using conjugates when we have to rationalize our denominators, okay? So if you do have a complex number like this where you're trying to divide, remember that I is a radical. So essentially what you have downstairs is a radical. You must multiply by the conjugate of that radical in order to get rid of the radical. And so what happens is whatever you do to the bottom of the fraction, you have to do the same thing to the top. And so what happens here is you have to distribute, okay? And then you have to distribute the BI And then of course you'll have to convert any I squareds to negative one, and you should end up with a real number and an imaginary number. At the bottom though, when you FOIL all of these out, the two terms in the middle should cancel. And so essentially what you end up with is the first guy squared and the last guy squared. Now you can shortcut it if you remember that. I don't, I just multiply it out and it is what it is, okay? So I won't ever shortcut this. I will actually write it the long way, okay? So if you're starting off with this fraction, you want to rationalize it, meaning get rid of the radical in the denominator. So to do that, I'm gonna multiply by the conjugate, which is 4 plus 2i. And what I do to the bottom, I do the same to the top. So 2 times 2 is 8, 2 times 2i is 4i, 3 times 4 is 12i, and 3i times 2i is 6i squared. At the bottom, 4 times 4 is 16, 4 times 2i is positive 8i, negative 2 times 4 is negative 8i, and then negative 2i times positive 2i is negative 4i squared. And so if you notice, these two guys do cancel, which is why they only had 16 minus 4i squared. Now I do know that this is gonna turn into a negative 1, and when it does, it's gonna change this sign, and that's why it's a positive 4 down here, okay? Now up top, it looks like they also converted this to a negative 1, which changes this sign, but these two guys, they combined because they are like terms. And once you have this without the I squared, you can combine them because they're real numbers, and so you get 2. So you have 2 plus 16i over this together makes 20. But this can be reduced, and so in order to reduce it, you're going to put 2 over 20 plus 16 over 20 with the I on the side. And then when you reduce this fraction, you get 1 over 10. And when you reduce this fraction, you get 4 over 5. And the I is still sitting there on the side. Okay. So we've got these problems here. We're going to work them out. So let's first start with number one. Now remember, standard form is A plus BI. So for number one, we have 2 plus the square root of negative 25. We have to use that rule that says we get the square root of 25 with an I on the side, right? The negative comes out as an I. Then I can actually take the square root of 25, which is just 5. And so this is in standard form. For number two, we have 7 minus I minus 6 minus I. There's an invisible one here to distribute and an invisible negative one here to distribute. So when I distribute this one, I get positive 7 minus 1i. And when I distribute this negative one, I get negative 6 and a positive I. Now negative I and positive I will cancel, but 7 minus 6 is 1. And that is in standard form. It just doesn't have an imaginary part. Now, number three, this one's a little interesting. So first thing is to distribute those ones like before. So it's not going to change these two terms. They're still going to stay the same. And it's not going to change these two terms. They're still going to be the same signs. However, I do need to take these negatives inside out as i's. And again, as long as these numbers are square roots and the digits inside are not more than 3 digits, you should be able to simplify that in your calculator. Square root of 8. So I get 2 square root of 2, but with an I on the side. And then the square root of 56. I get 2 square root of 14 and an I. Now I am supposed to combine my like terms. So negative 2 and positive 5 is going to be a positive 3. And I would combine my I's together. The problem is that these are not like terms. Although they do both have an I, the radical parts are not like. They're not like terms. They're supposed to have the same kind of radical. They both have square roots, but they also are supposed to have the same thing on the inside, and they don't. So unfortunately, I cannot combine those. However, this is not in standard form, because standard form is a real number plus something times I, okay? And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna right-hand factor out the I. Instead of factoring out the I on the left, I'm gonna factor it out and put it on the right. So basically these two I's are gonna come out. And so I still have positive square root of 2 square root of 2 and negative 2 square root of 14. I'm gonna keep that plus and then this 3. Okay. So then that's what we ended up with. And this is in the standard form. As weird and ugly as the answer looks, that is it. I cannot simplify that any further. Okay, number four is 3 plus 9i squared. So we have to remember we cannot square these individually. We do have to do 3 plus 9i times another 3 plus 9i. And so if I FOIL that out, I get 9 plus 27i, and then distribute that one, I get 27i plus 81i squared. The I squared will turn into a negative I, which will essentially, this negative one will change the sign of that. So it'll be minus 81, okay? There's no sense in writing a whole nother line when I already know that it's going to change that sign, right? So I end up with 9 minus 81 is negative 72, and 27 plus 27 is 54 I's. And so I've combined my like terms, and we are done with number four. Number five. This one's a good one, okay? These two things are imaginaries, okay? They're not real numbers, right? We know that the square root of a negative is not a real number. The rule that says that you can do this only applies to real numbers. These two things have to be real numbers. If they are not, if these two things are imaginaries like this, it does not equal this, right? Because a negative times a negative would give you a positive, so it'd be just that number times that number on the inside, okay? It does not work that way. If you do the problems like that and you just say negative 7 times negative 14 is equal to negative whatever that is, 7 times 14, 98. And if I type the square root of 98 in my calculator, it's going to tell me 7 square root of 2. This is the wrong answer, okay? I'll show you how to get the correct answer. So what you should do is you should take the I out. And you could put it in the front or put it in the back. I guess I'll be more formal because they really, really want them in the back. So square root of 7 and then out of the house is the I. And I'm gonna put a times because these are multiplied. And then the square root of 14, but with an I on the outside. Okay. So then what you do is now that these are real, you can multiply those together and get the square root of 98. And the I's multiplied together will give you I squared. So the square root of 98 in the calculator is 7 square root of 2, and the I squared is negative 1. So when you multiply a positive times a negative, you're gonna end up with a negative 7 square root of 2, which is not the exact same thing as positive 7 square root of 2, okay? So this is the correct answer. You must remember that this rule only applies if these two radicals are real numbers. Okay. Even if there were a cube, it wouldn't be an issue because I is not the cube root of negative one. The cube root of negative one is just negative one. Okay. So for cubes, it would still work, but for squares, it square roots, it does not. Okay. Let's see number six. Number six says to write the conjugates of these guys. So they want me to write the conjugates of these. This is weird because this does have a conjugate. The conjugate is 1 minus square root of 18. And then here, I would say that there's no conjugate, but I'm pretty sure they're going to tell you that the conjugate is negative square root of 3. So I really don't like this problem. What they should have done is they should have put an I here and an I there. So then, yes, we do have 1 and square root of 18i, but instead of a plus, it's a minus. Now here, it's helpful to remember that pure imaginaries can be written as a zero real part and then the pure imaginary part. And then if you have it in two terms like that, it's easy to tell that 0 would stay 0. This would stay square root of 3i, but the plus would turn into a minus. And then if you rewrite it without the 0, it's just the negative square root of 3i. Okay. So I would definitely, if you're looking at the note sheet, is add an I here and an I there. Outside of the radical. Notice that it's not under the house, it's outside on the side. Okay, number seven, it says to rewrite this. And again, this should have an I. For some reason, it does not have an I on the paper. So definitely make sure you make that correction. And then finally, we'll get to number eight, which is 2/6 - 7i. So for this one, we need to multiply by the conjugate. Remember, this is like saying there's no real part. So what is the conjugate? It would be 0 and then plus 2i, which is just 2i. So essentially what you're doing is you're multiplying by 2i, positive 2i, on the top and on the bottom, okay? So here we're gonna have to distribute, and here this isn't really there, I just wrote it in. We're gonna multiply these guys. So those together make 12i, these together make positive 24i squared, these two together make negative 4i squared. Now this I squared is gonna change this sign, and this I squared is going to change this sign. So this becomes 12i minus 24, and this becomes positive 4. And then I need to do some simplifying here. So it's 12/4 with the I minus 24/4. So I get 3i minus 6. This is not in standard form. It needs to have the real number in front and then the imaginary in the back. And make sure you keep the correct signs on each number, okay? This 6 is negative and that 3i is positive. And this is in its standard form. Now, similarly for number 8, I need to use the conjugate, and this one's a little bit easier to tell what the conjugate is since it's got the two terms explicitly written. So I'm just gonna do 6 plus 7i in the top and the bottom. On the top, I'm going to distribute this 2. And at the bottom, I'm going to have to FOIL it all out, okay, or distribute it all out. So I get 12 plus 14i. 6 is 6 is 36. 6 times 7i is 42i. Negative 7i times 6 is negative 42i. And then negative 7i times positive 7i is negative 49i squared. So this guy, we'll change that to a plus. And then I'm going to go ahead and put these two guys. Actually, they cancel. I don't even need to add them. They just cancel. So I get 36 plus 49. So I have 12 plus 14i over 85. And then I could split it. I have this and I have this with an I on the side. Now this isn't standard form, but I need to make sure that these fractions don't reduce. So let me type them in here. This one does not reduce. And that one does not reduce. So this is my final answer. If they did, I would have to reduce them. Okay. But they did not, so this is the final answer in standard form. Okay, well, that is the end of this section. Again, we will talk about I's a little bit more when we get to unit 2. Okay, we'll talk about them again. You'll see them again in pre-Cal, and you'll see them again in Cal 2 and Cal 3. But for now, this is just the beginning, and we'll go from here. But that's the end of unit 1, okay? So this is the very last section of unit 1.